Hi, and welcome to another episode of Straight Out of Camera, proudly sponsored by Fujifilm South Africa. Joining me live in studio is Managing Director of techsmart.co.za, Mike Hubert. Mike, how are you doing, sir?
Good, Eslie. How are you?
I'm very well. So today we're chatting about videography. Mike, I just recently went to a social media marketing workshop, and the emphasis was big on video. They reckon that video within the next 3 years is going to take over social media. What do you think about that?
I think it's definitely true. If we just look at the influence of, for example, posting videos on or Instagram stories, for example, you know, it's very much a video-focused world these days. It's easy to get a lot of information through a short period of video instead of text. I mean, I look at our own website on TechSmart. It feels like writing 1,000 words on a product is a lot of effort compared to making a short 1 minute video.
Don't you just think it's a little bit of a little fashion thing at the moment? Because, I mean, I remember in the 90s, videos were also much bigger than stills. But then stills started in 2000, so that started progressing. And, I mean, for example, when I got married, I didn't want a video. I just wanted stills images. Mm. Do you think that's maybe just the sort of feel that we're going through in the next 10 years, and then after that it goes back into stills again?
It depends, because I think it's very much technology dependent these days. Mm. The fact that everybody's got fiber, or at least working towards fiber, you've got 3G, 4G, and soon talking about 5G internet speeds on your mobile. I think that's driving the fact that you can watch videos now. It doesn't take time to buffer. You've got a little bit more bandwidth to play with. So I think at this stage, technology is driving that jump towards video. Yeah. If it's going to continue, well, you don't see a declining growth on YouTube.
Yeah.
The more, I mean, it's just staggering the amount of videos that's being uploaded. Also, taking into account that the production value of videos, if you take just the past 5 years from where they were in the past to where they are now, you've got some really decent, beautiful videos on YouTube.
But also, I mean, the equipment isn't that expensive anymore. Mm. You can probably get a nice video just using your cell phone these days. So a lot of guys that do YouTube are doing predominantly most of it through their cell phone. And then obviously, if you wanted to go into the 4K sort of scene, you can get a mirrorless camera for under 50,000 rand that can give you quality that you would probably pay hundreds of thousands of rands 3-4 years ago for.
Well, I guess our guest today, Rick Joachim, he's definitely going to talk about that, I'm quite sure. And then, you know, yes, indeed, the fact is that you've got your smartphone in your pocket. There's 1080p quality on most, actually. Mm. And then moving towards 4K on the cell phone side, too. So, yeah.
Brandlive.co.za.
In your face, all over the place. We're online 24/7. 24/7. You're listening to the hottest internet station.
Brand Live.
No doubt.
Have you ever thought about the power of social media? Social media has the power to make your business grow. Grow! Yeah. Why don't you let us manage your social media? Because our business is to see your business grow. Visit us at www.beastownmedia.co.za.
Our guest today is Rick Joachim, who is a freelance cinematographer coming straight from Johannesburg. Rick, welcome to the podcast.
Cool, thanks for having me. Thanks, guys.
How did you end up in cinematography?
I actually studied for it. I went to the University of Johannesburg. I wanted to actually attend a private college, but I couldn't afford it at the time. But I think I'd always loved films, always loved filmmaking and movies. And I think, I don't know, it's always just a passion of mine. So I slowly kind of found my way into it and got there. I have two stories if you guys want to hear about them, but growing up as kids, I think my parents, like, they hired, I think, the Ninja Turtles, the second movie ever. They kept hiring that for us on VHS. My mom used to hire that for us, and by the end of that stage, I think my mom told, like, my brother and I, she should just actually just buy it. It would be cheaper at the time. So we hired that a lot growing up. And then also growing up, I remember we had like a movie making 3D program on our computer, but we had a terrible computer. Our computer was terrible. It was a crappy computer. And you could make your own little films. You could make 3D films in this, but it was, I'm talking like, it was shocking. It was like old school 3D. And I used to always just try to plan like how I would move a camera through this building and over a building, and then the car crash would happen here and stuff. And I must have been like 10 or 11 years old, but that's
And the deal with the Ninja Turtles, how did that influence your career right now?
I don't know, maybe that's why I love weird like sci-fi kind of things, or weird like fairy tale kind of things. And I definitely just love the whole like idea of creating a whole world, or creating a whole new space and whole new films. So maybe it stems from that. Maybe it just stems from being weird. I don't know.
So apart from the Ninja Turtles, yes, and the strange little 3D, yes, program on an old computer,
yeah,
who else inspired you in the cinematography scene?
I follow a lot of cinematographers. I pay attention to a lot of guys. Bradford Young is one of my favorite cinematographers. He is an American-based DOP, and he shot Arrival. I don't know if you guys saw Arrival like 2 years ago. And who else do I love? I love lots of guys. I've drawn a blank now, but let me just think of some other guys that I...
While you're thinking, so did you know from that age that you would go into videography, or how did that progression happen from high school to actually studying it?
That's probably a little bit more... let me answer that. So I didn't always know I was going to end up in TV and film. I mean, like, for a long time, like, I had a love affair with music. I played in bands growing up, and maybe that also kind of was a little bit, like, ran parallel with that, in that... often we'd shoot music videos, and I loved the whole element of shooting music videos, because music videos on their own can be such a cool way to tell stories and tell narratives and like explore weird concepts without like having a lot of money and a lot of resources. So after high school, I took a year off. I did a year of sound engineering, actually, just to kind of find my way. Everyone seems to find to do that. I think Russell said something similar.
Yeah, I just wanted to say so.
I think a number of guests on here that did sound engineering beforehand.
I think it is quite cool. It's quite cool in that sound plays a huge part in for me, for films and like music and stuff. It's like, it's a big part of, it's half the visual is actually sound. I know it sounds so funny, but if you watch a movie with terrible sound, you won't forgive the film. But if you watch terrible visuals or like average visuals, if it's good sound, you'll kind of forgive it. So sound is very important. So maybe that's where we all kind of come through.
Yeah, it's also something that you don't really notice.
Yeah,
up until the point where it's actually bad.
Exactly. That's exactly it. It's exactly that. So it's like until you hear like something that's like, oh, that sounds terrible, I can't understand what they're saying, or it's just terrible choice of music, or whatever, that kind of bugs you. But so that's that. So then after that, I went to University of Johannesburg. I did 3 years at UJ, and I did my fourth year in honors, and I tutored while I was there just to make a bit of money, because I was tough being a student. And then after that, I was fortunate enough to start freelancing, and I've been freelancing now for the last 6 years as a cinematographer, as a DOP. I shoot commercials, short narrative films, music videos. I get to travel a lot for work, which is great. I did 9 countries last year, which was quite hectic, but it's amazing. It's places I never would have been able to see on my own. I could never afford to go to half those places. So I'm very fortunate for that. Like, I'm very grateful for like the opportunities my career has taken me. It's also tiring and hard at times, like being away from family and loved ones. But yeah, that's been my journey so far, condensed.
Coming from what you mentioned, the fact that you did music videos when you straight out of school, whatever, that was great. It kind of teaches you a DIY attitude in shooting, doesn't it?
Yeah, definitely. That's actually very true. That's a good point, because almost with music videos, you almost never have budgets. You never have money. I mean, up until now, I still work on music videos that never have budgets. And it just teaches you to be creative within boundaries, within like limitations. You have to just make a plan and get it done, and that, in some ways, it makes you more creative. It definitely teaches you how to like bend the rules a little bit, or just call favors here and there and make things happen.
Rick, tell us a little bit about some of the music videos that you've done.
Okay, cool. I've done quite a few. I'm not going to remember all of them off the top of my head, but I've shot some for the Graham Watkins Project, which is quite a cool band. They were nominated for a Simon Award. Short Straw, I've shot for a bunch of hip-hop artists. I've shot a lot of music videos. It's going to be hard to remember all of them off the top of my head. Most recently, the Bongo Zero Mabandla music video. I recently shot that.
Talk a little bit about that one.
Okay, cool. So I have always been a fan of Bongo Zero Mabandla. And I kind of developed, developed an idea about a double exposure music video. So I wanted to shoot using that technique. So in terms of photography, it's like one of those things where you shoot two images and you overlap them, and it's kind of like you do a double exposure. So I thought of a way, how can we do this in video? Like, how can I do it interestingly and differently? And I spoke to Eslie about it as well, and I ran it past him. And then we, obviously, the whole Fuji thing kind of developed from there. And it was quite cool. I approached Bongzu and he was sold on it. He loved the idea. And we kind of shot like for 2 days in studio and we shot a whole bunch of stuff for him. And I'm really happy. The video launches on the, can I drop the date? On the 4th of May. The video actually comes out on the 4th of May finally. Had access to the Fuji XH1 a year, well, not even, it was last year. It was like in December of 2017.
5 months before release.
5 months before release. And it was exciting to have this new camera that we weren't allowed to talk about, we weren't allowed to take pictures of or show on social media. It was quite great. And I used that camera the way I would use any other video camera. Like I use it the way I would want to use it. So I hooked up an external recorder to it. We recorded ProRes out of it, which gives you more like latitude and more information in post, so you can grade it a bit more, you can do pull better green screen keys, stuff like that.
I think maybe take us through your thinking process when you did that. I mean, we had girls turning on a sort of makeshift turntable vibe.
Yeah.
So maybe take our listeners through the whole process after you've sort of decided, okay, I want to do double exposure. There were certain of those double exposures that has a lot of meaning. For example, one dancer where it almost looks like his heart is exploding.
Yes, yeah.
That's something that you thought of beforehand?
Yes, yeah, definitely. It was hard. There was 142 shots in that music video. And I know that because one of my good friends, Shol Nordia, is an animator. He helped me with that. And without him, I would have been helpless. So I was so glad to have him. But we did plan a lot of those shots, but a lot of them also just happened. Some of them were happy accidents. But there were shots like we had Joe, one of the dancers, and we had like fire coming out of his chest. We had, what are some of my other favorite ones? We had like forests, we had trees and some people. We had...
It looked like the Gautrain sort of...
Yes, so we had some of those. We shot as much as we could as well of the plates and stuff. What are some other... I try to actually also play with elements. I don't know if you noticed, Eslie, but I try to play with like the earth elements. So it's like fire, wind, water, like that kind of stuff. Like the whole like... It's just kind of bringing in like... the nature aspects of it, because Bongzi also spoke about that, like kind of how do we bring it back to like the world or to earth and kind of like make it quite nature, because very much important. And then what other things we try to do? We try to just show like inner conflict. So inner conflict within people or inner conflict within or turmoil within the person and what they were thinking.
So these things were decided and planned beforehand?
Yes, yeah. The song, I'm trying to remember what Bongzi kind of, and what I understood the song is about. I don't want to speak on his behalf. It's fine. Let's leave that.
And where will this video be aired?
So it should go live on the 4th of May on YouTube and online and stuff, and then hopefully also to all the TV channels. So it should be good. So it's going to
So you could actually utilize a Fujifilm XH1 APS-C sensor camera for music videos on TV.
Yeah, definitely. For sure. Yeah.
Wow, okay.
Yeah, and it's 4K, so it was great as well. So that 4K also allows you a lot of space in post, which is great. So
I just wanted to mention that because people don't think that is the case. You know? Video is a new avenue for Fuji. And when I went to Japan about 2.5 years ago, we met with the guys from Cinema 5D. And they shoot with every single video camera out there. And the actual head of that organization said that the X-T2 was the best 4K camera at the price point that it was at. And I think for Fujifilm, it's definitely, this is the focus. So we're going to definitely be looking at video more seriously in the future. And your experience on the XH1, I mean, you said it was a hybrid camera for you.
Yes, yeah.
Can you maybe explain that to the listeners?
I think what's great is almost like, it definitely is a hybrid camera. So it's definitely I kind of find it quite useful for those who are transitioning, going from the photo world or having a bit of a photo background. So if you still take a lot of stills, but you want to mess around with video, I think the XH1 is great in that way. It feels great in hands as well. It feels really good. And it's actual 4K. Like I said, it's not, a lot of people kind of, or brands say to you it's 4K, but it's Ultra HD, which is not true. There's a big difference between that. So that 4K just allows you so much more resolution and so much more latitude, which is great. So it's easier playing with 4K footage and then delivering 1080p, because 1080 still survives today.
Yeah, so you have a love affair with a smaller camera that we manufacture called the X100T. Can you maybe just share a little bit about that with us?
I know that camera is a little bit of an older camera, but I love that X. I bought an X100T about 2 or 3 years ago, and it literally lives in my backpack when I travel. I literally have it on my shoulder. I was in Ivory Coast a week ago for work, driving through Africa and stuff, and I literally just have that camera on my shoulder and I pop it out and I take photos wherever I am. I've taken it with me to South America, I've taken it to Hong Kong. I just travel with it, and it's what I do love about it is it looks beautiful. The photo is straight out of camera. I don't have to do much. I don't have to edit it. I don't consider myself a photographer, but it keeps my eye sharp for cinematography. So if I have a camera on me all the time, it's always good practice that if I can take a really good photo almost anywhere, it means I'll be able to do the same in video and cinematography. But that X100T is great. It looks great. Don't have to do much. And I just love the form factor. It literally is a fixed lens. I think it's a 23 mil.
Yep.
It equates to about a 35 mil.
Range finder look.
Yeah, and it's great. I mean, it's tiny and it just fits. And like I shoot black and white a lot as well, which I love. The monochrome looks on there. The little film stocks look amazing. You don't have to do much.
If we want to do a shoot with Rick, how do we go about it? Is there an agency involved? How do people get hold of you?
So I recently signed with an agency. I signed with Exposure Crew, which is my agent now. So I have a talent agent, which is great. And her name's Daphne. She's great. And she helps me get all my bookings. And she's actually helped me change a lot of my stuff as well now. So I'm moving more into the commercial space. I shoot a lot of TV commercials now. I shot 3 commercials this week. Dying. It's hard to wake up this morning. But I'm loving where she's helped me take my career. So that's been cool. So they can Exposure Crew is who I have as my agent.
And internationally as well. That's where
it's normally, and you would not believe how social media plays a big part in this as well. Social media plays Instagram. I get so many messages via Instagram, people saying, can we hire you for a shoot, or what are you available? You want to come hang out? Someone will say I'm in London in the UK or something, and someone's like, hey, let's go grab a beer. I might have a project we can work on.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, that's how I actually got Barclays as a client once. Jeez. Actually. So I shot some stuff in the UK for Barclays, and it was actually just because the HR manager saw some of my work and said, come, let's talk about something. So
yeah, I must be honest with you, when Rick came to me at the Photo and Film in 2017, and he said, hey, I have a Fuji, I would like to do stuff with Fuji. I went onto YouTube and I watched his showreel, and the Halls advert was very funny. It's like this guy in a space,
like a spaceship. Yeah.
And he's just pew, 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 but it's for Halls.
And he kind of like runs out of like his voice, like, because the premise was there's no sound in space.
Yeah.
So he has to make his own sound effects, and thank you, Izzy. Thanks.
Let's quickly chat about crews. You mentioned the fact that you worked in the Ivory Coast last week.
Yeah.
But there were some problems with the crew there.
I think we are very professional in South Africa. I think we definitely, maybe I'll just like double prong this conversation, in that we almost play down our skills as South Africans. It's something I'm trying to get over myself even still. But we just assume that everyone's better than us. We assume just because they're American or British or European, they're better than us. It's not true. South Africans, we are so talented, so skilled, we just don't give ourselves enough credit. But then going to other parts of Africa, I did struggle a bit with other crews, because we are so good at being punctual and stuff that I struggled a bit with call times. Our call time was 8 o'clock in the morning and the crew arrived at like 12:30, 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And it's a 10-hour day for a commercial. That means you only got like 5 hours left.
But doesn't that like play a part in the lighting? You were looking at a certain lighting situation, and now it's gone.
Definitely. it was quite funny. I was with a director named Bongani Morgan, and him and myself were like, it was nothing to our fault. It's not our fault. So you just have to keep calm. It's almost like that duck analogy. You're like looking calm on the surface, but under the water, you're paddling like mad. And yeah, we got it done. We finished on time, which is great. We shot 2 more commercials while there, and it was a great experience. But just going back to just being professional, and we really are. I really do think South Africans, we work really hard. We try to prove ourselves, and we have some amazing talent here.
Other places that you like traveling to?
UK. I'm a big fan of the UK. I love London. I've done America, parts of America, San Francisco, parts like that have been great. And then Europe's been great as well. I've done some of Asia. I did struggle with it, just cultural differences and stuff. It's a bit of a weird place to go to as well. It's just very busy, so it's always a bit strange. Where else were we? I did recently did Iceland. My girlfriend and I did Iceland, and we went to go see the Northern Lights, the Aurora Borealis, and that was amazing. That was one of the best holidays I've ever had. First time I've actually gone away for a holiday and not work-related trips.
The countryside there?
Yeah, beautiful. It's literally, while we were there, it's winter, so it's only 5 hours of daylight a day. So the days are very, or 4 hours, very short, but beautiful. You can literally point a camera. You can literally point a camera like anywhere.
Tell us, I'm a big YouTube fan. Do you believe that YouTube could be a medium for people that want to get into your industry to sort of learn a lot before they actually go to tertiary institutions? Do you believe tertiary institutions are worth going to?
This is a brilliant question. It's something I talk about often. I really don't believe you need to go study anymore. I really don't think you have to go. And a lot of people can't afford it. And I understand that. For me, I think there's so much knowledge and there's a wealth of knowledge on YouTube nowadays. Like, had I had the opportunity, I probably just went straight to YouTube and I probably just started learning there. So I don't feel guys have to study anymore. You don't have to. There's so many guys out there teaching amazing things. And another thing is cameras have become cheaper. Technology is way cheaper now. You don't need to, like, you can actually just buy a camera and start shooting music videos yourself. And that, by making those mistakes and by like learning like that, you'll grow so much faster in some ways as well. Like, education isn't everything in that way.
How do you get into the music video scene here locally in South Africa?
It is a bit tricky. It's also very much who you know, and you kind of have to build up a little bit of a showreel and like have a bit of a rep after a while. Mm. It's a bit silly like that. But I definitely believe by doing it is how you're going to do it. If you do an amazing music video, three other people will take notice and someone will contact you and they'll say, we want you to do this again, but yes, maybe a little bit more money.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
So it's by doing stuff. No one's, something I feel with my own career, I feel like no one's ever just going to notice you out of nowhere. You have to do something.
And then social media, you said it played a big role in yes. your life.
Yeah, I kind of treat my Instagram kind of like my showreel in that way. I try like just post relevant pictures. Every once in a while, I try post screen grabs from my video stuff. I often do. I just wrote a recent commercial now for one of the banks, South African banks, and I'm going to post a few screen grabs from it soon. And just I'll kind of tag what camera I shot it on. I'll tag how we shot it, how we approached it, what we did. And I'll just post like 5 or 6 photos from that. And then people notice. And hashtagging is really important nowadays as well. So,
Rick, where can we find you on social media and on the internet?
You can find a lot of my stuff on Instagram and on Vimeo. So on Instagram, it's RICKJOAQUIM. And then on Vimeo, it's vimeo.com/RICKJOAQUIM. And yeah, and that's pretty much the two platforms I live on right now, and they've been great.
Awesome. Thank you so much for joining us in studio.
Cool. Thanks, Rick. You guys. Thank you very much for having me.